Hi, I'm Mike North. I'm a principal staff engineer at Stripe and the tech lead of their developer platform org. In enterprise-scale TypeScript, we're going to start by discussing app versus library concerns and an approach to modular architecture that lets you feel the benefits of working in a small project, even though your project might be big. We'll build a TypeScript library together from scratch, and we'll go through an incremental adoption strategy you can use for TypeScript or for adopting stricter type checking and linting rules. I hope you take the knowledge from this course and use it to build awesome TypeScript projects that scale up well, even when the number of contributors gets big and your level of complexity starts to get interesting. Let's run yarn type check and yarn test. Type check and test. It's going to run our jest tests that are in this repo for us. They were already there. Okay, we got a couple things popping up. So let's investigate these one by one. And again, I'm scanning through here and I want to find the lowest level pieces of code that I can start with first. I see a couple things in the utils folder and the data folder. Those are, in this project specifically, y'all would know best in your respective projects, but we all have a sense for what are like the low level, you know, format a date into a string kind of functions, and then React components are sort of higher level where they're grabbing node modules, they're grabbing those date formatting things, and they're putting them all together. So let's start here. So we have one error here, const d equals new deferred. It says it expected one argument, but got zero. And it looks like we've had a constructor argument here for deferred that we haven't provided. So let's take a look at deferred. Well, it turns out we're not even using this description. Like, we're not using it anywhere. But I'm going to follow the practice that I would advise you all follow, which is like it's tempting to remove this, but we're trying to perturb this project as little as possible. And so what we can do here is just say, let's make it optional, even though it's unused. Like, let's pretend it might not be, but like, let's make it optional. We're really trying to avoid changing the resultant code that spits out, like the JavaScript code that comes out of this process. Anytime you do that, you run the risk of introducing a bug. And it's not that we shouldn't fix this, but it should be fixed separately from this conversion step. Something like that. Now you may notice, let's see. Look at that, see description colon any? What we're seeing here is that since we've converted this to TypeScript now, this type information from JS doc is ignored. And it may seem like it would be useful to like still pay attention to it here, but imagine a world where we have something like this. How do we reconcile that? Like which type information should TypeScript pay attention to? Sometimes the docs are built based on this, right? So really, it's just saying, look, you can define types right in the code now. That's where you should be doing it. So you'll see a couple occurrences here where we're going to have to just bring this into our code. And by the way, this type checked as a JavaScript file before because this was optional with the square brackets here. It just failed to type check once we said, it's a mandatory argument you got to provide. Sorry, we'll keep the word description here. That's better. Okay, so this file looks good now. Let's look at our api.ts. That looks good. I don't see any red errors on the gutter here. Let's look at error.ts. Seems good. Networking seems good. All right, let's run our type check again just to see how we're doing. We're gonna have, okay, so we're good on the utils folder. Now let's look at data. So here, what's this happening here? API call, an argument for init was not provided. Hey, it's another thing that TypeScript no longer understands as optional. That's my bet. Let's go and look. Let's click into API call. Sure enough, you know, this has square brackets. So I'm just going to bring this type into the code. It's kind of like that. And then the string, put it for path. And let's see, I'm going to type check one more time. If we get lucky, we might fix a lot of things. Three errors in two files. Okay. Again, starting with the principle of like lower level file first, let's look at channel. All right, loading. It's the same error we were seeing before. We solved it with JSDoc. JSDoc types are ignored now. We're just gonna have to bring this into TypeScript world. Something like that. Get rid of the comment, run it one more time. There are my tests running. The fact that I'm seeing my tests run means that the type checking passed, right? Because this is the command. Yarn type check has to pass for the test to run. And they ran. And of course, there is a test for deferred, right? So here you can see we've got a version that passes a string. There's probably one. Oh, I always pass a string in. So it seems like our tests really wanted to pass this string in. We didn't have to touch our tests. As far as we can tell, most of what we did was bring JSDoc types into TypeScript code. One of the things we lost as we started to ignore JSDoc is like optionality of properties. And so I would say this was a nice disciplined conversion step where we didn't, it's very low risk that we perturbed, code more than we should have. And we're gonna do a sample code change and then we're gonna run this command and see what happens, see what we would see in a pull request if someone were going to make a change. And we'll make a really tiny little change where in the stringify error function, which is in index.ts, we're just gonna make this optional argument required. Just delete the question mark, save it. Yarn build with docs. It's doing the build. It's doing API extraction. It's rendering new markdown docs. We got a little warning here, and this is what you would see as a developer. So I told you we'd discuss like, what does the dash dash local argument for API extractor mean? And the fact that we dropped it means it's not gonna automatically update that etc, markdown file. This one here. This hasn't changed. Look at my gutter on the right. No indication of Git changes here. But in the temp folder, this is sort of like a staging area. And note that we don't have a question mark here. This is not checked into Git. So we're not seeing a Git diff of any kind here. But if we compare the two, like that one has no question mark. This one absolutely has a question mark. And we're being prompted, like if we really want to make this change, to copy the temp, the file in temp into the etc folder. That's really what dash dash local does. So where might this behavior be useful? You might have in CI something that would run this command, and at this point it would fail. You would say, you have a code change that is not represented in the API surface report. There is a misalignment there. Sometimes you want that to fail. This would be what would catch a case where someone just made the code change and then opened a pull request and like they didn't run the API extractor and they didn't run API documenter. And that's valuable. That's why I leave dash dash local off here so that, you know, you'd make sure that this command finishes successfully. It's failed. Well, sorry, you would configure this being a failing error. You can, in the config, set it up to fail. But that's why omitting dash dash local would be of benefit here. So we'll just do the manual step here. Okay, and now we can run this again. You probably don't have to run it again this time because it didn't actually fail. It just showed a warning. But there's a lot of tunability in terms of what's a warning and what's an error. And we can look at, this is what the PR would look like. These are the files that were touched. So here, of course, we have the code change, right? There's a removal of the question mark. This second argument is no longer optional. Here is how the API surface report changed. So this would be where you'd look, you know, maybe there are a bunch of different changes in this PR, and maybe only one of them actually affects the public API surface of this library. And as a code reviewer, you would look at this and you would say, okay, I can see exactly how consumers of this library will be affected. This is a breaking change now. Anyone who depends on not needing to pass that second argument, they're going to need to update their code now. So let's talk about that. Maybe that's what we want to do, but who knows? And then finally, there's the update to the markdown file documenting this function. This is a nice complete code change here. Docs, API surface report, and the change itself. This is where we're getting into modular architecture. And what we're going to do in this chapter is bring that library that we created together at the beginning of the workshop, chat-stdlib. We're going to bring that into our chat project. And in doing so, demonstrate how you can just use Yarn and get a lot of the benefits of a monorepo. This is something you can't do with Yarn 1.x. You need to have a modern version of Yarn in order for this to work. What we're going to look at first is like, how does Yarn understand that we're working with a monorepo here? So we'll look at the root level package.json, and this is very important. When we're dealing with Yarn workspaces and have a workspaces property in our package.json, that is describing where all of the packages can be found, right? Where you call each one of these things a workspace, where the various workspaces can be found. This is a convention that a lot of people follow. They have packages slash, and then every subfolder of packages ends up being its own workspace. So I'm following that here, but you could make this whatever you like. And what that means is, if we close this up a little bit, these are all different packages here, right? So if you've taken TypeScript fundamentals or intermediate TypeScript, here are our notes for those two courses. This is the course website. This is a fundamentals little like Hello TypeScript project. Here's that HTTP error dependency we brought in that didn't have any type information, but it had this like HTTP error class. Turns out that has been in here as a workspace. And now we're gonna work with these two. We're gonna bring this package into this one here. The benefits will become pretty clear as we do this, but the first benefit we're gonna, I think we already see, is you get encapsulation, right? Here, we're not publishing a package, but we're building a dist folder, and it has a very deliberately created DTS rollup where we can say, this is a private thing, no one should be able to call this. I can opt into beta features, right? So you could have some stuff in here that's sort of internal, right? You're managing complexity by doing this. We'll see other benefits in a moment here. But for now, let's bring the package in. So we're going to go to chats package.json. And we're going to add a new dependency here. Chat, standard library. And that's pretty accurate there. Workspace colon star. So this is the special Yarn workspace thing. NPM will not understand this. So don't try to use this with NPM or you're in for a bad time. Now we're gonna go into our networking TS file. This one here in our utils folder, which is currently very unhappy because it's missing its stringify error thing. And here we're just gonna say chat stdlib. There's stringify error. Oh, it has no exported member. I think some of you might know what we'll have to do there. And that is opt into the beta. So we'll go into our tsconfig. Actually, I'm just going to copy it because we already did this work for the tests for this little library. Right here, we're just going to need this line, right, to get that beta stringify error function. We got to point it to the correct types. So I'm going to apply this to the outer, that's the tests tsconfig. I'm going to put it in our main tsconfig. So we already have a paths object there. can get rid of that. Add a comma. All right, I'm just gonna think carefully about what the relative path is to get to that file. So I'm in packages chat, so I wanna go one up and then into chat stdlib. So this will get me out to packages, and then I'm gonna enter into chat stdlib dist, and then there's the beta, and go back here, and the error is resolved. Stringify error is coming through. There's the beta annotation there. So we're now consuming this as a dependency, right? It's as if it's in our node modules folder.